Okay, well, I will try it straight away, see what happens. Very good. Huh? Is it healthy? It's good, yeah? Okay. Good. Very good. Very nice. Okay, so let us carry on. So now we're going to have a look at the five spiritual faculties. These are called the Pancha Indriya in Pali. And the idea of Indriya, and the reason why it is translated to faculty in English, Indriya is something which kind of is a power. It overpowers other things. It has the ability to take charge. Yeah, it is like an ability of the mind. The point is that when you have these five Indriyas, especially when you are a noble one, these become powers because they are ever present in your mind. So they tend to kind of lead you, they tend to take charge. And that's why they become Indriyas. So you have the ability to access Samadhi quite easily. This is one way that you know that someone is an Arya. Yeah, if you are a stream entry, you have an easy access to Samadhi. Samadhi is one of the factors of one of the five Indriyas. Why is it easy to access Samadhi if you are a stream mentor? Well, it's easy because you have seen reality. You have seen the nature of reality. Because you have seen the nature of reality, you know where dukkha is, you know where sukha is. Because you know what is dukkha, you can give it up. Yeah, if you know that something is dukkha, it's easy for you to let go of all of that. And the things that get in the way for attaining Samadhi are typically the five senses. Yeah, the sensual world. So because you know that it's problematic, you know it's suffering, you can give it up. You can go straight into Samadhi. So by definition, someone who has real insight, they will attain Samadhi easily because that insight is actually what is required to abandon the stuff that gets in the way from Samadhi. And that insight is what the five Indriyas are about. It is as I said before, you are a stream mentor, they are the ones who have these five Indriyas. So you have that inside, so all the other things become powers, that become part of that package, if you like, of these five qualities. So this is basically what they mean. So they are abilities or qualities that are established in the mind, for this reason they are obviously very useful, and you are then on the path. Now, what about the rest of us who are not noble ones? What do you do? Does that mean that you haven't got these five faculties? And what exactly does it mean? And what it means is that you still have some degree of those faculties, and sometimes they are there, sometimes they may be absent. Yeah, the problem with the mind of an ordinary person, it fluctuates a lot. And sometimes you have a bit of wisdom, sometimes you have very little wisdom. Sometimes you feel you have faith, sometimes you haven't got much faith. Yeah, it's like bang, kind of bouncing around like that. Sometimes you meditate, it works quite nicely. Other times your mind is all over the place. I'm sure you have all experienced many of these things, because most people do experience things in this particular way. So our job is to approximate and get closer to the five Indriyas. And this is part of the development, is that development to making these Indriyas stronger. So one of the things we're going to have a look at is how to develop these Indriyas, how to make them powers in your own life, until hopefully one day, you can make the breakthrough to actually get these things to be permanent aspects of who you are, permanent aspects of your personality, if you like. So these are these five powers, and I think power is just really an alternative name for Indriya. Bala and Indriya being roughly synonymous, or having a similar kind of meaning anyway. So let's have a look at the first sutta I want to have a look at. Is not the first one in the sequence here. The first one I would like to have a look at is found on page, it's very nice that these are page numbered actually, it's good. Where is the master of page, oh there he is, yeah, so Bobby is the one who made this into page numbers. Are you the one who made it into page numbers, Bobby? Yeah? Yeah, so that's actually very handy now, so thank you for doing that. Yeah, but you told them to do it, so you have a part of the, yeah, part of the merit for making pages, yeah. So well done. So if you can turn to page 109, that's the first sutta I would have a look at. So this is a little sutta. These suttas here about the five Indriyas are almost all taken from the Indriya Samyutta. And in case you don't know about the suttas, how they work, there is a whole collection called the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, the Samyutta Nikaya. And the Connected Discourses of the Buddha are suttas that are grouped according to topics. So you have various topics, and for example, one of the topics is the indriyas, the five faculties. So you have a whole collection of about 50 suttas, 50 individual discourses just on the indriyas. And you have a similar kind of thing on the Satipatthanas. You have a large number of suttas on the Noble Eightfold Path, on the Bhujangas. So if you want to read about the 37 Bodhipakya Dhammas that we're looking at now, that is really the place to look. The Samyutta, the Connected Discourses, have five books to them. The last one is called the Mahavagga, or the Maghavagga, depending on who you ask. And in there you find all of these 37 Bodhipakya Dhammas, the 37 Aids to Awakening. They're all part of that collection. And one of those, the 48th Samyutta, is called the Indriya Samyutta, suttas on indriyas. So this one here is the 18th sutta called Practicing Here. And it's a very short little sutta, and it's just to give you a little bit of background as to how these things work. Mendicants, this is Ajahn Siddhartha's translation for bhikkhus. A mendicant is someone who collects alms. Mendicants, there are these five indriyas, these five faculties. What five? The faculty of faith, the faculty of energy, the faculty of mindfulness, the faculty of immersion, and the faculty of wisdom. So straight away, do you know what the faculty of immersion is? Samadhi, yes. Why is it translated as immersion? Is that a good translation? What do you think? You like the translation? Immersion? Does it make sense? Maybe. This is Ajahn Siddhartha's translation of the Samadhi Indriya, the faculty of immersion. And I'll just maybe explain a little bit the idea behind this. One of the nice things, very often in the suttas, Samadhi is translated as concentration. And of course, the idea of concentration in English has very kind of unfortunate side effects, because it often means using willpower and all of these kind of things. And often it becomes an obstacle to your meditation practice, because you use too much willpower and force. You concentrate the mind, you grab hold of the breath, and you hold on to it as if you are doing some kind of exercise at school or at work. You have to focus, and you use the same kind of power that you use because you have to work hard. If you are, for example, an air traffic controller, it says it's one of those jobs that needs a lot of concentration, because if you make one mistake, you're an air traffic controller, then you have a big lot of casualties as a consequence. I didn't see that one plane coming in, okay. Then there is a serious problem, so you have to be very careful. But of course, to be able to do that, it is not always natural at work to have concentration. Sometimes you may be doing something that you don't really enjoy, something boring, you have to write a report or read something. So you have to use force to be able to read it. And that's why when you come home from work, very often you feel kind of exhausted. You feel, enough, and you just want to relax and you kind of chill. This is kind of natural. So for these reasons, how we translate the Pali words actually have a lot of effect on how we think about them, and then how we practice. Sometimes it's not even clear to us that this is happening. It can be subconscious, but it often has a subconscious effect, and then you get it wrong as a consequence. So Samadhi, the way that Ajahn Brahm likes to translate it, which I have followed, is stillness. So when I translate Samadhi, I always translate it as stillness. Because it is, doesn't have anything to do with force about it. It just means peace. It means that there is nothing happening. It's all very quiet inside, and it's quite evocative. It evokes a feeling inside of you of what Samadhi is all about, stillness. So I remember I was discussing this with Ajahn Siddhartha, because I know him very well. We stayed together in the same monastery for many years, which is Bodhinyana Monastery. So I told him, why not stillness? And he didn't like stillness. He didn't like stillness because he said it's too ordinary. Stillness is something people use in ordinary speech, but Samadhi is something very profound. So we need something more to really get the meaning out of Samadhi. And the root meaning of samadhi, and this is where I think he was coming from, part of this is the idea of, I think, immersion, which comes out of that. And if you think about the idea of immersion, it's a word which is a little bit kind of highfalutin, a bit technical, but to be immersed means that you are fully contained in something. If you are immersed in water, you have water on all sides. Yeah, this is kind of idea of immersion. So the idea of immersion as a translation for samadhi is that you are completely immersed in this experience. There is nothing of you going outside of that experience. You're fully contained within yourself. The senses are not really going out anywhere. And you have this one sense left, and that is the sense of samadhi. So in a sense, it is a nice translation. It gives a good feeling for what actually is the real meaning of samadhi, the idea of being contained within one sphere, within yourself. I don't know, I must admit, to me, I feel it is, I don't want to criticize Anna Sujata, but I feel it's maybe, to me, it doesn't really have that strong emotional connection. Immersion is a bit too intellectual, perhaps, or something like that, it depends. Yeah, people have different feelings. One of the nice things about having different translations is that you start to see different angles on the same view, on the same word. Sometimes one translation cannot capture the full meaning of a word. So sometimes it opens up your eyes to alternative ways of looking at the word when you see different translations. Yeah, so you can think a little bit of concentration is okay. Stillness is wonderful. Immersion also gives you an angle on the meaning of this word. And altogether, it starts to give you a feeling for the idea of samadhi, what it actually means. So that is the background, yeah? You can imagine the number of hours that have gone into arguing about these words before they actually come out like this. Yeah, so this is one of the one of the things that happens as a monk, you really get into these little things, but it's actually wonderful because these things are important. So anyway, I will explain more about these faculties later on, but for now, let's just note that these are the five faculties. And then the Buddha says, someone who has completed and fulfilled these five faculties is a perfected one. A perfected one is an arahant. Yeah, this is the translation for arahant there. So when you have these five to the max, you have developed them all the way, they have become super duper strong, then you are an arahant. If they are slightly weaker than that, you are someone who is practicing, you are on the path to realize the fruit of perfection. I don't know if that makes any sense to you at all. What it means is that you are almost an arahant, and you will attain arahant probably later on in this life. You have attained some state whereby it is kind of guaranteed that you will become an arahant later on. Yeah, that's really what it means. That's what I take it to mean. And if they are weaker still, you are a non-returner. Yeah, you will never come back to the sensual world. Or if you're not quite a non-returner, you are practicing to realize the fruit of non-return. So again, you're close to being a non-returner. If it is slightly weaker than that, you are a once-returner. You will come back to the sensual realm one more time. It's interesting how these things are so clearly defined, isn't it? It's kind of almost strange. Practicing to realize the fruit of non-return means that the five faculties are still weaker. Or you are a stream enterer, they are still weaker still. Yeah. Or you are practicing to realize the fruit of stream entry. This is sometimes called the Saddhanusari and Dhammanusari in the suttas. It's the first stage at which you be called an Aryan, a noble one. And from that point on, you are guaranteed to reach awakening in at the most seven lifetimes. So each one of these is weaker, but even if you are just practicing to realize the fruit of stream entry, you have the five faculties, yeah? They are there within you. So you have that wisdom, but they're not super strong yet. This is there's a lot of interesting points about this, but one of the interesting points about this is that things like sati, for example, it is sometimes assumed that sati, mindfulness, is something that either you have it or you haven't got it, but actually that is not quite true, because sati comes in the large degrees of different strengths and qualities. So you start off with a sati of being a stream entry, or someone on the path to stream entry, which is already very good sati compared to most people. Already you have a clarity of the mind, you rarely get confused about what is going on, you don't really get caught out with your mind being all over the place. But still, it is not super power that you are very, very present. So it then goes up and becomes more and more powerful. And this is why, for example, when you have a really powerful samadhi experience, you come out of samadhi, then sati will be extraordinarily powerful when you come out. And it is that ability to have sati, which is very, very strong, that enables you, gives you more power to have insight into things. This is one of the reasons why samadhi is so useful for insight, because it makes sati stronger. So sati is not just sati. Sati comes in a large variety of degrees, depending on, makes a difference in how present you are right here, right now, and your ability to see things clearly. So this is one of the little points that actually I think is an important point, because sometimes people think either you're mindful or you're not. Actually, it is not really as simple as that. And then the Buddha says, someone who totally and utterly lacks these five faculties is an outsider who belongs with the ordinary persons, I say. There's two things to this idea of utterly lacking any of the five faculties. One is that you are an outsider, and one is that you are an ordinary person. An ordinary person in the suttas is the putujjana, is the Pali word for that. And putujjana, jhana means person, and putu means like many. So it means like you are one of the, it's like a many person. Yeah, it's like the, in other words, the ordinary, the regular people in the world are the putujjanas. In other words, this refers to the non-Aryas, the non-noble ones. But the other word is just as important here, the idea of being an outsider. An outsider means someone who is not a Buddhist, someone who doesn't have any faith in the Dhamma, someone who has faith in some other teaching or some other religion or other sect. That's also significant here, because if you're an outsider, you have no faith in the Dhamma, so you don't even have the first of the five spiritual faculties, because you haven't even got the first one. It doesn't even start. There's nothing there. It's empty. But for the rest of us who are Buddhists, you have some faith in the Buddhist teachings, but you're not yet an Arya, you are a noble one. Well, we are somewhere in between there. You have these faculties, occasionally you have them, occasionally you haven't got them. Sometimes they are strong, sometimes they are weak, you have some of them but not the others, or whatever it is. So we are kind of fluctuating in the middle there, and then suddenly one day you give up Buddhism, you become an outsider, then you are, bang, you're out of this again. This can happen. You see, sometimes you hear people, you give up on Buddhism. I didn't make any progress in my meditation. I stopped believing in all that nonsense. Now I'm a Christian. Christianity much better. Sometimes you hear about these things, and you think, gee, they really, they lost something so wonderful and marvelous. I grew up in a Christian culture myself, and I must admit, I never found Christianity very impressive. I don't really understand why people become Christians, to be honest. Anyway, that's what people do sometimes. But this is life, and things kind of fluctuate and move around like this. So we have to be careful, and we have to keep on pursuing this to establish these particular five spiritual faculties. I'm just putting that there just to show what I was saying before, that these are really only exist fully if you are a noble one, and that if you are not a noble one, then there is this problem of the faculties being very unstable and uncertain. But now I want to go back to, now that we have decided that, now I want to go back to the analysis of these five spiritual faculties, page 102. And we can have a look at that. Page. And this is still staying in the Indriya Samyutta, Samyutta 48, this is the ninth sutta, is called analysis, and the Pali word for that is vibhanga. And the word vibhanga is something that you come across a lot, so it's kind of can be handy to know. And so this is how these are explained in the suttas, and they are explained in different ways, and we're going to have a look at a couple of different ways that these faculties are explained. Monks. So now we have monks. How come we have monks? How come we don't have mendicants? What happened? What happened to the mendicants? Okay. This one, he must have a fault in his translation, I think. No, it's not Bhikkhupada because it has mendicant just further down. Yeah. So I think this is Ajahn Sujata. So how come it says monks there? And this what's going on here? Maybe this is an older version that I have or something. Yeah, okay, don't know what's going on here. I'm very confused now. Anyway, so I need to strengthen my faith faculty, obviously. So mendicants. There are these five spiritual faculties. What five? The spiritual faculty of faith, of energy, of mindfulness, of immersion, and wisdom. And what is the faculty, spiritual faculty of faith? It is when a noble disciple has faith in the realized one's awakening, that the Blessed One is perfected, a fully awakened Buddha, accomplished in knowledge and conduct, holy, knower of the world, supreme guide for those who wish to train, and teacher of gods and humans, awakened and blessed. This is called the faculty of faith. So this is the faculty of faith, and which is very interesting. Obviously, the idea of faith in Buddhism is around the Dhamma and the Buddha, but here it is specifically related to the awakening of the Buddha, and that you have faith and confidence that the Buddha was awakened. First of all, the idea of faith, what does that actually mean in Buddhism? Because one of the problems with the word faith, it is an English word, and one of the problems with the English language, like any European language, that European languages are steeped in European culture. And European culture is really a Christian culture. And because it is a Christian culture, all the language is kind of has Christian ideas almost built into it, because that is the culture of the of that area. In the same way, if you go to Indian culture, it will have Indian ideas built into the language. Words like Dhamma and Atta, which are very Indian words, are built into the understanding. In Malaysia, which is largely Islamic culture, there will be Islamic ideas built into the culture. So every culture has a bias, and the language is biased because of that. And a word like faith is a very Christian word. The interesting thing is that in Buddhism, the word does not have exactly the same meaning as in Christianity. In Christianity, the idea of faith is you believe, and you believe regardless. And sometimes it is said that even if it is completely illogical, that is where you get tested, to see if you really believe or not. And if you really believe when it's not logical, that means your faith is really strong. To me, that's completely illogical. To me, doesn't make any sense. And I think that this is very different from our approach in Buddhism, which to me is far more satisfactory here. In Buddhism, it is not really about just having blind faith like that. In Buddhism, the idea of faith is actually very closely related to wisdom. And this is kind of the weird thing. Whereas in Christianity, it can perhaps in some cases be a part of wisdom. Sometimes it can also be completely divorced from wisdom. Faith is just this purely emotional faculty whereby you give yourself up to something. Why? Simply because you do it for whatever reason, because other people tell you, because it's part of the culture or whatever else. But in Buddhism, it isn't like that. In Buddhism, wisdom and faith go very closely together. And because they go so closely together, sometimes it is better to translate saddha. Saddha is the Pali word for faith, as confidence. Because really what it is that as you read these teachings, as you study this, as you practice it for yourself, as you start to understand what is going on, confidence is growing. You feel more, yes, this is it, this is right, this makes sense. The Buddha is talking about psychology, and it fits with how I experience the world. The Buddha says craving as a problem, craving leaves you never satisfied. Well, I actually, we all know that that is true, because we know, we can feel that, we can experience that in our everyday life. So the Buddha's teaching is a psychology in large part. I said before, it's not a philosophy, so what is it? If anything, it is a psychology. And that psychology, because it is a psychology, it is something that relates to individual people's lives. So you know straight away there must be some truth to this when the Buddha says these things. You may not know everything, and for that reason there is also a degree of faith there for those things that go beyond. But because you already have some degree of confidence, the faith is not as blind as it otherwise would be. It is a faith that is already somehow related to something that you already know. And this is kind of what how Buddhism works. So the idea of Buddhism of Saddha is this idea of both faith on the one hand and on the other hand confidence. Confidence and faith going together. This is really the idea of Saddha in Buddhism. And how does that, how do you experience Saddha? How do you know that you have Saddha? One of the things, and this is one of the reasons why faith can be an appropriate translation, because the idea of faith in Christianity is often a very emotional experience. And in the same way, faith in Buddhism too should really be an emotional thing. Yeah, when you have faith in the Buddha, whatever, it should actually give you a sense of uplift. It should give you a sense of joy. It should give you something, a feeling inside which is very positive. That is when faith really is working. And this is why you see in the suttas very often when you start off with your meditation practice, very often you do start off with the contemplation of the Buddha. It's called the Buddha Nusati, the recollection of the Buddha. If you have faith in the Buddha and you recall the qualities of the Buddha, and this is just what we're doing here, I just read out the passage on the qualities of the Buddha. This is the standard passage, Ittipiso Bhagava Arahang, etc. If you recall that in the right way and you have faith, it gives rise to emotions. Positive emotions, and then those emotions, that joy or that gladness of the heart, they become the foundation for your ability to meditate properly. This is the kind of emotion that we need for mindfulness to become strong, for mindfulness to stick to the meditation object. Then when mindfulness sticks to the meditation object, that is when samadhi becomes possible. And this is something you see throughout the suttas, how that basic joy faculty often coming out of a recollection of the Buddha Dhamma Sangha is the foundation for the entire rest of the meditation practice. I will show this to you later on, because this is a very important part for how to understand Buddhism and how the path works. It's a very practical significance, because this is actually what enables you to make meditation work properly and achieve some of these states that are part of the Buddhist path. So this is faith. On the one hand, it is emotion, but on the other hand, it is also understanding. Yeah, it is kind of a more like an intellectual appreciation to see that, yes, this makes sense, to see that it works in your own life, that it fits with how you experience the world. Yeah, so it is also an intellectual consent to these teachings. Yes, I agree, they make sense, these are real teachings. That is the confidence part of things. Yeah, so Saddha in Pali has both an emotional side, and it also has what I think in English sometimes called a cognitive side. A cognitive is like the more intellectual side of things, whereby you agree to a teaching because you know it makes sense. So both intellectual and emotional are part of Saddha. And so this is a kind of a double meaning. And this is why sometimes in the suttas you find this word inspiration is translated into English, the Atta Veda or Dhamma Veda in the suttas. And the Pali word, Dhamma is the teaching, Atta is the goal or the purpose of these teachings. Yeah, and the Veda in the suttas is derived from the word Vedana. Vedana means feeling. But Veda also has the idea of understanding. Yeah, the word Vedeti in Pali means both understanding and feeling something. Yeah, just what I'm talking about now, the both intellectual and emotional side to these things. And for that reason, it is often right to translate Veda as inspiration. When you are inspired about something, how do you feel? Well, you feel emotionally uplifted, but you also feel like understanding. Yeah, it's inspiring something is this kind of the light bulb goes on, you see, and then you feel inspired and kind of things come together. So inspiration is an important part of this. The Veda also very closely related to this. And this is, again, one of the things that makes these things so different in Buddhism, the close connection between wisdom and saddha and faith and confidence, so closely connected. And this is why when we talk about the five faculties, we say only the stream enterer has the five faculties. You need to have the full insight to have faith. Yeah, it is only when you have the full insight, the full understanding, that your faith becomes fully strengthened. So it is from wisdom that faith has kind of reaches its maximum. The more wisdom you have, the more faith you have. Yeah, if you have no wisdom, then you have no faith. Or you may look like you have faith, you may kind of be going around bowing to the Buddha and putting flowers on the altar, but it's kind of a very superficial faith. The deep faith that really understands and really is emotionally connected to the Buddha's teachings may not be there. So wisdom and faith are two sides of the same thing in Buddhism. Yeah, which is very kind of very fascinating. So sometimes you can check out how much wisdom have you got. Well, you can know that from your faith. So if you feel really emotionally connected to the Dhamma, it probably means you have some wisdom going there. And if you have no emotional connection, it's all kind of intellectual stuff, then the question is it real wisdom? Real wisdom gives rise to emotions, which is kind of interesting. Yeah, wisdom and emotions go together in Buddhism. So sometimes we think of kind of emotions as superficial, or we can think of wisdom as superficial, or intellect as superficial, but actually when they come together like that, intellect and emotions, that is when you have the real wisdom, and that is what we're looking at on the Buddhist path. So it's a different way of looking at things from what you normally understand, either in the secular world where we're looking at intelligence and intellect, or in many other kind of faith traditions. Buddhist outlook, as always, has some kind of little things that make Buddhism kind of make it special, and this is kind of perhaps one of those. So what is that faith faculty specifically? And specifically, it is a faith in the awakening of the Buddha, the realized one's awakening. Yeah, and then you have this set of qualities here that are mentioned here, and this set of qualities is actually a very interesting set of qualities. I've already talked about them earlier on this retreat, and maybe I will talk about them a bit more, but perhaps not now, because we'll come back to those later on. But one of the things that you will realize that maybe I should just mention now very briefly is that this set of qualities, they all are around two things specifically. One is the wisdom of the Buddha, his insight into the nature of reality, and the other one is the fact that because of that, he is the supreme teacher of the world. Yeah, these are the two things about the Buddha that these qualities kind of revolve around. Nothing there about supernormal powers, nothing there about anything kind of intellectual or philosophical. It's all very practical and down to earth and about the insight of the Buddha. Of course, one of the interesting things about this is also that when you have confidence or faith in the Buddha, you also, by definition, have confidence in the Dhamma, because the Dhamma comes from that awakening. And if you have confidence in the Dhamma and the Buddha, you also have confidence in the Sangha, because the expression of that Dhamma practiced properly is precisely the noble Sangha, or those noble ones who have achieved this. So faith here is larger than it may first appear, but the basic faith is the faith in the Buddha's awakening here. So how can you have faith in the Buddha's awakening here? I'll talk about that later on, maybe not now. But it's interesting, yeah, because the Buddha lived 2,500 years ago. He is consigned to history, well and truly. And how can you have faith in someone who lived 2,500 years ago? Does that really make any sense? The answer to that is, of course, it has to do with his teaching, with his Dhamma. Yeah, this is kind of where it comes together. And what is interesting about the faith in the Buddha, it is actually possible here to know that the Buddha was awakened. That is kind of the radical thing. How can we know that the Buddha was awakened. How can we possibly know that? And it seems really over the top, but the way that you know that is because you have an experience through practice in these teachings that give you an insight, and especially this is about the insight into non-self, that is so radical, that is so earth-shattering, that you understand only someone who had the same insight would have been able to give these teachings. So you know that whoever gave these teachings, you may not know exactly who it is, yeah, okay, the Buddha, yeah, he lived 2,500 years ago, we know from history roughly who it was, but you know whoever gave these teachings would have had to awaken to the same truth, because now you have seen it yourself. That is how you can know that the Buddha was awakened, yeah, because you see things in the same way. Then, of course, through historical research and through reading the suttas or whatever, you realize that actually this person is probably the historical personality we know as the Buddha, Gautama, Buddha Gautama, who lived 2,500 years ago. And one of the purposes of the first part of this retreat was to look at that person. Who was that person we called the Buddha Gautama, who lived 2,500 years ago? And hopefully for those of you who are here, you have a bit more feeling for the Buddha as a consequence. You get a feeling for him as a real person, yeah, as a real teacher. And this is very valuable, because when you get a feeling for the Buddha as a teacher, actually it is often more easy to place confidence in him, because you see the qualities, you see the person, and you see all of these things coming together, and it all builds up a picture, a real life picture, almost as if he was sitting on the stage here, yeah? That would be nice to have the Buddha sitting on this. Would that be nice, or would it be scary to have the Buddha sitting there? I'm not sure. It kind of be a bit of both, yeah. But actually, no reason to be scared, because the Buddha obviously is the most gentle, the most kind, the most compassionate person in the world. But somehow we are still scared. It's kind of strange, isn't it? Why are we scared of somebody like that? But that's often somehow how our irrational mind sometimes works. So this is faith faculty. I'll talk more about faith later on, because it is the first one of the five faculties, it is the most important one, yeah? And this is one of the things that I always think is a very important point to understand about the Dhamma. The Dhamma is very structured. These teachings are not random, they are never kind of five things put together at random. So when we talk, for example, about the five khandhas are not just five things randomly, any order is okay. They are specifically structured according to a certain thing. Everyone has a very clear purpose on the path, and that's why it is in there. And everything in Buddhism is like that. The five nivaranas, the five hindrances, again, have a very clear purpose and a very clear sequence. It may not be obvious, but they do. The eight factors of the Noble Eightfold Path, the five spiritual faculties. And one of the suttas I'm going to show you in a minute, or maybe this afternoon, or whenever we get to it, shows you the sequence of the five faculties and how one leads to the next one, if you do it right. And when you have these kind of sequences, where one leads to the next one, where it is a causal sequence, now that causal sequence is very obvious in things like dependent origination, that one thing leads to the next one. But actually it is much more thoroughgoing, and you find it in so many places within the Buddhist teachings, and also as part of the five faculties. So whenever you have that, the first one is the most important one, because if the other spiritual faculties don't arise, it is because of a lack in the first one. That is where most of the effort or most of the investigation needs to be placed. And once that becomes strong, then the other ones arise more or less as a consequence. Why? Because it is a causal sequence. One thing causing the next one. Duk, 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 duk. Then it becomes automatic, yeah? Get the first one right, everything else, bang, happens like a miracle because the first one is right. But there are no miracles in Buddhism, so that's the wrong way of looking at it. So I'm deluding you by saying that. So, faculty sad indriya, the faculty of faith, confidence. Either one of those will do. Let's move on to the next one, the faculty of energy. It's when a mendicant lives with energy roused up for giving up unskillful qualities and embracing skillful qualities. They are strong, staunchly vigorous, not slacking off when it comes to developing skillful qualities. This is called the faculty of energy. So first of all, energy, what does it actually mean? The Pali word is virya. Yeah, so one of those important Pali words that you hear a lot about. Is it the same as padana or vayama on the Noble Eightfold Path? The sixth factor of the Noble Eightfold Path is samma padana or samma vayama, yeah, which means a right effort, really. Yeah. So what is the distinction between effort and energy? Yeah? There is another word also related to these four. This is atapi. Yeah, atapi is often found, for example, in the Satipatthana Sutta. We'll have a look at it later on. And it is the reference to the effort or energy in the Satipatthana Sutta. So also related to this. Atapi in the Pali is related to the word tapas. And tapas is the ancient word used by all the ascetics of ancient India when they did self-mortification, yeah, when they tortured themselves. This is called tapas in the ancient Indian terminology. And atapi is a little bit related to that word. And that's why sometimes it is kind of called the burning up, yeah, of unwholesome qualities, atapi. It is the effort whereby you burn these things up in the same way that tapas. Tapas actually means burning. It's like the sun burns, it's tapas. In the same way, the ancient Indians, they would, through ascetic practices, they would burn up the negative qualities in themselves. And this word atapi is related to that. But in Buddhism, it means something different. It doesn't have that same quality of mortifying yourself or practicing ascetic practices to an extreme. It doesn't have that anymore. In here, it means more like the effort that we do to overcome the unwholesome qualities. So all of these words are related to each other. Vayama, padana, atapi, and virya. Don't have to remember these words, I'm just saying them out. Yeah, as I mentioned the other day, if I use a few Pali phrases, it makes me sound more professional. Yeah, so I like to use a few Pali words in between. Virya and padana. Virya is energy, padana is effort. And one of the difference between these words is that virya is a naturally occurring aspect of the mind, yeah? And you will have noticed that, every one of you will have noticed that in your own mind, yeah? Sometimes you feel more energetic, sometimes you have no energy at all. I'm not talking about physical energy, I'm talking about mental energy. Sometimes you feel bright, you're reading something, and you feel really interested, or in your meditation, you feel quite bright, yeah? Other times, there's no brightness at all, there's no energy there, there's complete, you can't even read, because there's so little energy in the mind sometimes. So energy levels in the mind are very variable. It's a naturally occurring thing. Yeah? Whereas padana is not a naturally occurring thing. Padana is the effort we put into something, is the trying. Yeah. So these are two slightly different things. So padana is when we deliberately try to avoid unwholesome things. You say, stop, I shouldn't say that. That is a bad thing to say. So you stop yourself. That's padana. But virya is the energy that is already in the mind. So the virya, if it is strong already, it helps you with your effort because you already have an energy, and that energy makes making effort easier. So energy is a higher thing. Padana is a lower thing. When you have the energy, you're closer to enlightenment. Padana is something you have to do even if you are less close to enlightenment. You're further away from enlightenment, yeah? Padana is the effort you always have to put in, and eventually that leads to energy. And when you become energetic, then the effort becomes so easy by comparison. Do you see the distinction between the two? Yeah, one is like the beautiful energy of the mind makes everything much easier, but padana is the effort that we sometimes have to put in, even if we haven't got the energy in the mind. So the energy is this naturally occurring thing. And here, in the factors of, because these are the factors of a stream entry or someone who is on the path to stream entry, already they tend to have virya. You tend to have virya because you understand what is going on, yeah? So you already have the joy, you have the mindfulness that comes with understanding the nature of reality. And your energy is natural because you know the importance of this and you are already inspired by these things. So a stream entry has a natural energy to the mind, yeah? And this is one of the things that if you look carefully, what is very interesting is that if you look at people, people who are Aryas, noble ones, will tend to be energetic people. Yeah, they will tend to be kind of tirelessly giving, tirelessly teaching, tirelessly meditating, whatever it is. They have a natural energy to the mind. And this is one of the factors. And I have noticed some of the greatest teachers that I know, they are just enormously energetic. They kind of talk all night. Instead of not tired, they still kind of keep on talking. It's as if they have this source, this nuclear reactor inside of them that keeps on blasting out. Yeah, this is a term I got from Ajahn Brahm. He said that when you come out of jhana, it's like you feel like a nuclear reactor. That's what he said once. And I said, oh, okay, I better stay, you know. That sounds, but it very powerful energy that comes from inside of you. So this is the energy. And then here, you apply that energy to overcome the unwholesome qualities and to increase the wholesome qualities. Yeah, this is how you apply that. For a stream enter, it's much more automatic. It happens almost by default. As soon as you see the unwholesome quality, straight away the stream enter turns away from that, because you know it's like a hot coal. If you touch that unwholesome quality, you're going to burn. So you bang, that goes straight away. The stream enter knows it's a hot coal. If you're not a stream enter, you don't really know it's a hot coal. You think it's fun. Yeah, getting angry. Sometimes you need to get angry, because sometimes people behave badly. You've got to tell them off. So anger is not the hot call. You've got to pick up the hot call. Okay, no worries. Wait a minute. Something wrong with this. And then you let it go. It takes a bit longer before you realize that anger and upset actually is something negative, both for you and also for the people around you. So then you let it go because of that. But for the stream mentor, it's more automatic. For the rest of us, it takes more contemplation, more right view, more thinking about the Dhamma in the right way, and then it happens. So slight difference here. So slight difference between Sammapadana and the Virindriya that we are seeing here. This is the faculty of energy. Yeah, the energy which drives your mind in a positive direction. And then from that energy comes the next one, comes the mindfulness, because the energy is all about abandoning the unwholesome qualities. And as those unwholesome qualities get abandoned, the mind gets pure and bright, it gets present, and that is one of the most important aspects of mindfulness, the presence of the mind. How is that defined here? And this is quite interesting. This is different from what you are maybe used to hear about mindfulness. What is the faculty of mindfulness? It's when a noble disciple is mindful. Not just anyone, but a noble disciple. They have the utmost mindfulness and alertness and can remember and recall what was said and done long ago. This is called the faculty of mindfulness. That's interesting, because normally the way mindfulness is described in the suttas by the Buddha is as the four satipatthanas, yeah, the four mindfulness meditations or the four applications of mindfulness. That is usually how it is understood. But here it is described as remembering what was said and done a long time ago, with clarity, and this sort of thing. This is what. This is one important description in the suttas about this. And this is what we discussed the other day. Someone asked the other day what mindfulness really means. And she was saying some people says it means to recall, to remember. Other people says it means the ability to be aware. Yeah, and in fact, it means both. And both are very, very closely connected to each other in the suttas. They are basically almost part and parcel of the same thing. If you are really aware in the present moment, it leaves very deep impressions on your memory, and it's easy to recall later on. If you are aware in the present moment, it is also easier to recall what happened a long time ago. So two are very closely related to each other. And this is one of those little things that shows you how generosity, for example, works in Buddhism. I mentioned this also before here very briefly, but the idea of generosity in Buddhism is like an art, the art of generosity. Generosity is not something you just do just like that. The more wisdom you have around generosity, the more impact it will have in your practice. So, and one of those things is that when you give when you feel inspired to give somewhere, when you feel joyful about giving somewhere, that is when your mindfulness will also be strong, because when you feel joy, the mind will naturally want to be in the present moment. When you are in the present moment while you're giving, and you feel joyful and happy about it, it leaves a powerful impact on the mind. Because you're present, it leaves a powerful impact on the mind, so it becomes a very strong memory. Then later on, when you meditate and you bring mindfulness back again, it's easy to bring it up, and then it becomes a power in your meditation practice. It becomes part of the chaga anusati. The chaga is generosity, anusati is recollection, so it becomes a recollection of your generosity in the past. So this shows you directly the connection between mindfulness and memory. There's a very powerful connection there. And you can use that in your own practice in this particular way. So how able are you to remember things from the past? And you will notice how variable it is. How incredible variable it is. Sometimes you can't remember anything. You just a blur. Everything's just a big blur. Don't know what's going on. Other times you can remember really well. And one of the things, of course, is when you are mindful, when your mind is clear. For me, it's so obvious that this is the case. When your mind is really clear, well, you can remember so well. Everything comes out of you. You can remember, you can remember the Pali you're supposed to say. You can remember everything. Other times, you can't remember a single Pali word. You can barely remember dukkha sometimes, even though you are really immersed in it. You can hardly remember it. So the connection between the two is very strong. So this is an alternative way of thinking about sati, is as this. And again, it is very useful, because when we have alternative definitions, it makes the whole thing more easy to comprehend what is going on. There is another interesting thing. This is actually found in the Bhojanga Sangyutta, and there is a Brahmin who comes to the Buddha, and he says to the Buddha, sometimes I can remember all of these Brahmin spells and hymns, the hymns of the Brahmins, the Vedas that the Brahmins have to remember. And it's kind of an amazing feat of memory when you look at what they have to remember. These thousands and thousands of verses, and really obscure, nobody really understands what many of them mean. So they remember, and it says to the Buddha, well, sometimes I can remember, sometimes I can't. And the Buddha says, well, the reason for that is because sometimes your mind is obstructed by the five hindrances, and sometimes it is not. So when it is obstructed by the five hindrances, you mess it up and you can't remember it properly. And even if you remember, you remember it wrongly. But when the five hindrances are gone, that is when you see things clearly. And of course, the five hindrances are again very closely related to mindfulness. We saw this before in the other sutta. You get rid of the five hindrances, mindfulness arises. You have the five hindrances, and mindfulness is always going to be weak as a consequence. So this is another angle on the same problem. So this is the satindriya, the faculty of mindfulness. So if you are a noble one, you will tend to have a really good memory. It's another thing that you can sometimes see happening. What is the faculty of samadhi, the samadindriya? And it says here, it's when a noble disciple, relying on letting go, gains immersion, gains unification of mind. This is the faculty of immersion or samadhi. So noble disciple usually refers to the Aryas. This is the Aryasavaka is the Pali word. The noble hearer, because the disciple is one who hears it. You hear it from your teacher. And then you have this thing here, relying on letting go. Vosagga ramanang karitva is the Pali. And vosagga is one of these words that means to let go. And what you're letting go of here specifically vosagga, the first thing that we let go of on the path is the sensual world, the five senses. So not the pen, we don't let go of our pens, we let go of the five senses. So sorry, I apologize, I'm being naughty. So We let go of the world of the five senses. And the word aramana is sometimes translated as object, but really aramana in the suttas, that aramana as object is really a later use, a use that you find in the Abhidhamma and that sort of thing. But aramana in the suttas means like a foundation or a basis. So having made vasagga a basis, having made relinquishment, giving up a basis in your life, having made that a foundation, then you attain samadhi. What does it mean to have made relinquishment a basis? It just means that you have practiced relinquishment, you have thought about it, your mind is attuned to the idea of giving up. I was just reading out yesterday a very beautiful sutta on the dangers in the sensual objects in the world, all the five senses, and that kind of reflection that you find in that sutta, the simile of the borrowed goods, the simile of the dream, the simile of the hungry dog and all of that, which shows you the danger in the world of sensuality, that is what leads you to making vasagga, relinquishment, a foundation. When you think about that enough, you start relinquishing a little bit mentally because you understand it is unsatisfactory, you understand it is problematic, and then you let go. And you make that relinquishment more and more and more, not through force, not through sitting down and kind of living a very simple life through force, but usually through just automatic means, by reflecting in the right way and reflecting in a good way. That is how this happens in the ideal circumstance. So you make this a foundation by right view, by reflecting on it, by practicing some degree of restraint, but restraint through wisdom mostly. Then when the foundation is well laid, then samadhi happens. Why? Because the biggest problem for attaining samadhi is the five sense world. This is the biggest problem. As long as the five senses are awake and we are attached to those five senses, samadhi can never become that deep. So you make the foundation of giving up, then you gain, it says here, immersion, you achieve samadhi, and you gain unification of mind, chittassa ekagata. And this is just an alternative description of samadhi, chittassa ekagata. It means the ekagata means one-pointedness or unification, chittassa of the mind. And one-pointedness means the opposite of being distracted. The Pali word for distracted is vikatta. So the vikatta, vikitta, vikitta. Okay, something like that. Vikitta, I think it is. And so the mind is distracted externally, moving here, moving there. Chittassa ekagata is the opposite of being distracted. You are unified on the object. This is one way you can know what the meaning of the word samadhi is, non-distraction. So this is why you can sometimes have lower samadhi. Lesser samadhi would be when you are reading something and you're fully focused in what you're reading. When you're watching a movie and you're completely engrossed in the movie. You had that experience? It's like you are there, and when the hero is crying, you cry, and when the hero is happy, you're happy because you're fully immersed in the movie. Sometimes these things happen. That's a kind of samadhi, but it's called Miccha samadhi in Buddhism, wrong samadhi. But it's a kind of samadhi as well. You're fully there with the object. So that is really what it refers to. And so you can see that with the breath meditation. Sometimes you're with it, sometimes you're not. To enable samadhi to happen, you have to enjoy what you're doing. That's a classic example of the movie. If you enjoy it, then it's really easy. If you don't enjoy the movie, then it's very hard to be focused. And in meditation, exactly the same thing. You are fully focused because you enjoy the meditation object. We have to make it nice. We have to make it enjoyable. Then it becomes possible. Okay, let us have a look at the last of these five spiritual faculties. I'll just look at that very briefly. What is the faculty of wisdom? It's when a noble disciple is wise. They have the wisdom of arising and passing away, which is noble, penetrative, and leads to the complete ending of suffering. This is called the faculty of wisdom. These are the five spiritual faculties. So wisdom of arising and passing away, this means that you know arising here means something that originates out of nothing, and passing away means it passes away into nothing. So it's origination and ending. Uddaya gama, Udaya Attagama is the Pali. Udaya, not Udaya. Udaya, yes. Udaya Attagama. Udaya means originate, and Attagama means to end. It literally means to end, completely to come to an end. So you see how, you understand how things arise. This is how, where it gets profound, yeah? How things arise out of nothing, and then how they cease into nothing afterwards. Yeah, this is kind of the idea behind this. So you have seen this, and you have seen this for all phenomena. This is what this means. So this is the full insight into the Dhamma. One way of looking at that insight is that you have understood how all phenomena in the world arise out of nothing, cease into nothing, coming and going, and disappearing in this particular way. This is what is meant by the one way of looking at the idea of full insight. It is noble because you become a noble person when you see this. Yeah, it's a profound insight. Penetrative in the sense that it penetrates the nature of reality. You see reality as it actually is. And it leads to a complete ending of suffering. Once you have seen this, you have no choice but to get to the end of suffering here. That's good, isn't it? Yeah, suddenly you are on the highway to the ending of suffering. Yeah? No choice anymore. Yeah, you're kind of being woof. It's like you're on a conveyor belt. Yeah, and moving towards the end of suffering at the end of that conveyor belt. So this is called the faculty of wisdom. These are the five faculties. Okay, so that is the initial look at the five faculties. We're going to have a look at them a little bit more this afternoon. But for now, let us have a break until at least 11 o'clock, and then let's do a little bit of more meditation together, maybe half an hour meditation together afterwards, and then we can all go down and for lunch. So we'll see you back here for the next sutta reading at 1:30, yes, very good.